Hello and welcome to another edition of The Wedding Experts. And today we're positively blooming because the subject of the show is flowers. I'm Andrea Ventress, Deputy Editor of Wedding Magazine. And together with my team of experts, we'll solve all your modern day bridal dilemmas. Coming up on today's show, we meet a bride-to-be who has a rustic venue but can't help going colourful with her flowers. We help her do it with class and elegance. Plus, how to match the flowers to your bridesmaids' outfits and to do it within budget. Plenty of money-saving tips from our top florists. Joining me today is Beth Ivory. Beth, welcome to The Wedding Experts.
Thank you very much.
So, congratulations on getting engaged.
Thank you.
When's the big day?
It's in a few months' time. We've booked a lovely venue in rural France, in the Dordogne. But we're having a little bit of a dilemma about the flowers.
Okay.
The venue itself, as I say, is very rustic, and we've sort of been advised that wildflowers look really nice, but I'm worried they might be a little bit bright.
Okay, and bright's not the way that you want to go?
Not really, I'd rather have things a little bit more low-key.
Okay, excellent. Right, well, we've got an amazing expert lined up for you today, top London florist, Jamie Aston, and I went to see him recently to see what he had to say.
I'm Jamie Aston, and I've been working now for myself for the past almost 4 years. We do, on average, about 85 weddings a year. We travel all over Europe and even to the States. So most brides would go for the classic white and green look, as you see over here, the kind of roses, which are very, very typical for most weddings. For the bridal flowers and buttonholes, it's always appearing somewhere. You've got the freesias here and paper white, which are great for scent, really kind of old-fashioned looking flowers. And the lilac, which is just there to the left, which is very pretty, that actually has a kind of very much a bad luck meaning to it. So some brides who are superstitious would never ever choose that flower. And mixing the lime green there with flowers like blue hydrangeas that you see here, it's kind of very kind of strong blue, and hot pink ranunculus here. It's a real kind of clashy combination. I guess for this bride particularly, to kind of combine colours such as the lime green, the kind of soft blues and the hot pinks here, and even some kind of pastel pinks together as well, like the stocks you see here, would be quite an exciting combination. With your guests that come to the wedding and what they expect to see, I guess they're looking to see the personality of the bride running through the whole day, and that includes the flowers too. And if you're a really kind of bold personality, it makes sense to have really bold flowers that actually are classy and work with the venue and work with your personality and bring it all together. And it can be quite shocking. You can create a lot with bright flowers, and you can colour the water, and you can do all kinds of wonderful things to get an impact. I think when it comes to budgets and what a bride should allow for her flower budget out of her whole budget for the wedding, it varies on what they're trying to achieve on the day and on the venue as well. If it's an amazing venue that is very ornate, it doesn't always need tons of flowers. If it's very rustic and very simple, like a barn, say, you can go kind of very simple, just bottles of flowers. So it depends on the venue and on what they probably have and what they're trying to achieve. I think the biggest dilemma for our brides when it comes to their flower choices and their design for their wedding, I think firstly it's confidence. They're not sure on the ideas they have and if they're going to work. And that's always the biggest issue to kind of overcome. They come here to be reassured in some way. And often their ideas are fairly good actually. And it's just kind of giving the kind of go to go with them and to encourage them to push it. I think also being realistic with their budgets, that's also quite tricky. We try to coach our brides to tell us what their budget is, really, which sounds pretty awful, but actually, without knowing what they want to spend on their flowers, it's really hard to kind of cater for their needs and give them what they want. And I guess the third issue for our brides would be to try and convey our ideas to them so they can visualise them. So in the first meeting, when brides do come to you with a kind of a blank canvas and they're not sure actually what they want, there's no colour, there's no design, nothing at all, just a venue and a dress. And you've got this kind of this bride who gives you her style, her personal style, and you're trying to kind of give her ideas that will work for her and for the venue and make her dreams come true. I think it's very important to get the flowers right for your wedding. They are there on the table and you're eating, what, for 3 hours almost? And then your face for 3 hours. At the church, they're there, they're very apparent, the bridal bouquet's in the bride's hand. It runs through the whole day. So I think it's very important.
Lots of lovely flower ideas, and Jamie, you've joined us in the studio, welcome. And welcome to Victoria Sullivan, our style editor on Wedding Magazine.
Thank you.
So, Beth, probably it's probably best for Jamie to get a better idea of the kind of things he could produce for you. Give him an idea of your dress and the whole sort of style of the wedding.
I'm trying to keep everything quite low-key. The venue is very rustic and the dress I've got is laced from head to toe, quite vintage style. So that's why I'm worried about the bright wildflowers.
Bright flowers can work really well. They can kind of stand out even more in a kind of opulent kind of castle or chateau, which you could have. They can blend in against the kind of golds and the reds and the kind of opulent colours. So in a low-key venue, they can add a lot. So I guess if most brides is trying to be brave and kind of push it a bit and just go for it, and it does always work with a good florist.
So you would go for some bright colours, because obviously it's a lovely summer wedding. What kind of colours would you be thinking of?
Me personally, I think kind of lemons and oranges, soft pinks and greens. So kind of you can go for pale colours with the odd bright colour put through here and there.
I think that would work nicely.
So you're toning it through. I think kind of lemons and pastel pinks and a bit of bright pinks and some red maybe could look pretty stylish. So it's still fairly safe with the pastel tones going through. And going for a kind of a very bright kind of yellow and hot orange kind of display obviously isn't you.
No, it might be a bit much, and I think.
Yeah, it would clash with the venue too, I think. So I think pastel tones would work a bit better.
So Vicky, I know that you put together the lovely bouquets and table centres section in Wedding Flowers magazine. You must have a really good idea of the kind of flowers that would work well. What kind of varieties are your favourites for this kind of venue?
Well, I think that particularly if Beth's going for a French Provençal kind of feel, I really think that lavender's probably a very important flower that she should be using within her bouquet or within the table centres. Other beautiful wild flowers would be poppies, which come in some beautiful orange colours, which aren't too zesty, but are pretty enough to brighten up a venue. Other flowers she could use which would look lovely would be chrysanthemum blooms, which a lot of people don't like chrysanthemums, but actually blooms, they are really big chrysanthemums and they look really, really pretty, particularly in some zesty sort of orangey colours and some yellows if you want to brighten up the table centres at all. Not really for your bouquet, but definitely for table centres. I think for a rustic venue, you really need to brighten up the venue with some bright colours on your table centres.
Mm, you talked about bouquets. Jamie's, what kind of ideas would you put together for Beth's bouquet if she's going for a very vintage lace dress?
Is it sparkly as well?
Or? A little bit of sparkle, yes.
Okay, and it just hangs down from under
yes,
here?
Yes, yeah.
So quite elegant, quite eveningish.
Yes.
Okay. I think for you and maybe your character, quite a kind of a stylish bouquet, quite small, probably a kind of round, compact posy would be lovely, with some kind of Demonte going through the bouquet, quite kind of low recessed, so they don't stand out too much. Or even a very kind of simple trailing bouquet, so just some orchids maybe, just three or four stems tied together with some grass looped through, very simple, very light too, whereas a rose bouquet or a compact dome bouquet can be very heavy. You've got 40 or so stems all bound together, where a trailing kind of bouquet of orchids with three stems is very light. You can swing it around and hardly know it's there. Because carrying a bouquet is quite a foreign thing to be doing of your hands, so rather than feel nervous and twitchy, it's easier to carry a lighter bouquet.
And cost-wise, a wired bouquet, that would actually cost a lot more, wouldn't it? Why is that?
Yeah, it does, a lot more. I mean, a wired bouquet will take a good florist, a good, you know, kind of 3 hours or so to make. Each head is wired separately, each leaf is wired separately, and that's a lot of labour. So, particularly in London, that's, you know, a lot of money on labour. Mm. So, unless you're really kind of wanting one, I wouldn't go down that route. They are pretty, but they are a lot of money. You can get £200-300 for a wire bouquet, which is that big, whereas a kind of a loose bouquet can have as much impact and can be, you know, kind of a third of the cost.
Mm. So actually, talking budgets, Vicky, what's the average cost of flowers for a wedding? I heard something about 10%.
Well, that's what we'd like it to be, really, but I think that's not always what they want to spend. You know, from our survey that we did, sometimes it comes back that they only want to spend £500 on their flowers, which I'm sure Jamie will agree is not a lot, and you can't really get a lot for £500. So really, I'd advise 10% if you really want show-stopping flowers, if not more. But, you know, for some people, they don't feel it's as important. But I think anyone that has been to a wedding, that there's been money spent on the flowers, always remember it. And I think it always does stay in your memory as a wedding you won't forget.
So if you are slightly tight on costs, what kind of tips would you give to make the most of your money?
Well, I think going along with Beth's theme, I think it would be particularly important for her to have some herbs, especially as it's very French, very rustic. So herbs and foliage is a really good way of cutting cost. Obviously, they'd look great in terracotta and pots, just in a very kind of Provençal feel. Then otherwise, I would just look at looking at seasonal flowers. Don't try and go for flowers that are out of season. That does bring up your cost a hell of a lot. So seasonal flowers and just think about how you use your flowers as well. If you're having your ceremony and you're having ceremony flowers, try and move those into where everyone's sitting down to eat, because then they can have a focal point to look at, and also you won't have to double up and you won't have to spend money on ceremonial flowers as well as having big pedestals in your reception area too.
So is this something that you would do, Jamie, if a bride wanted to move a pedestal, say, from the ceremony area to the reception? Is this something that the florist can
do? We do, and it's a lot of fun, actually. It's kind of a race against time. So we do charge that service, because you have to wait around at the church for 40 minutes to an hour. That's more labour again. Labour is obviously an extra cost. Then we try to plan the flowers in the church so that we can move them easily. So the plinth is light, the vase is empty of water, the flowers on a tray. It's very simple to move it in three pieces. But the issue is the timing. If your guests are all leaving the church and the venue straight away, there's no time to do that. So it can be tricky. And there have been some times with us before it has been very, very tight. And it's embarrassing. If you're there with the guests at the wedding and you're the florist moving big displays of flowers,
yeah,
it can look pretty tacky.
Awkward.
Sometimes, I think. It doesn't, yeah. I mean, yeah, you need to be well planned and have back doors to go out of and so no one can see what's going on. But it does work, and if you've got time, if your guests can go onto a bus around London or in France, you know, in little cars or on a boat trip somewhere for half an hour or for pictures, there is time to florist and to do that, but it's tricky.
So it's all about the planning and the timing. And obviously your day, Jamie, is a very long day. You're starting very early, I take it, as a florist?
Yeah, it's an intense day. So 5 o'clock start sometimes, and you're working through till 8 o'clock, or even later. With weddings, particularly in events, you're kind of up early at the market, getting the flowers sorted, making the displays, installing them, waiting around, and collecting it at the end of the wedding. So you can be up from 4 or 5 o'clock, and then getting to bed at 3, 4 in the morning.
Wow.
So it's a lot of fun.
Yeah.
We're all say it is, us florists.
We say they're worth their weight in gold. Thank you so much for joining us, Jamie, and thank you, Vicky.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Beth. Still to come on The Wedding Experts, we meet a bride who'd like to match her flowers to her bridesmaid's outfits. See you after the break. Welcome back from the break. Joining me now is bride-to-be Katie Deer. Hello, Katie.
Hello.
Now, I believe you have quite a specific floral dilemma.
I do. My dilemma is, well, it's twofold, really. My bridesmaids will be wearing a peacock blue colour, so what flowers
right.
go with peacock blue, if any? And secondly, my dress is quite detailed and full, and so what kind of shape bouquet would work best with that kind of dress.
Okay, and where are you having your wedding? Where's the venue?
We're getting married in a large church in Ottery St Mary in Devon, mm-hmm. and the reception's in a country house hotel in Devon.
Okay, so do you have any kind of theme in mind?
I don't think I really want a theme. Flowers are so beautiful, I'd kind of want all different colours, really, particularly in the reception. Perhaps not so for the bride to carry in the bridesmaids.
So let's see what our floral expert has to say. We've lined up for you Kally Ellis from McQueen's, top London florist, and I know that she's got loads of lovely ideas. Let's have a look.
I'm Kally Ellis and I own McQueen's Flowers. It started 18 years ago and we're renowned for our contemporary designs primarily, although we do everything across the board. We don't pigeonhole ourselves. We cover all aspects of floristry, including weddings, all events, contracts and retail floristry as well. The most common problem I find with a lot of brides that come in to see us is they really don't have a clue of what they want. My advice to them, usually, when I initially take the phone call from them, is to bring anything they have to hand that will help me help them. For instance, if they've been flicking through all the magazines, if they can bring the tear sheets with them, if they know what they're wearing, that always helps, the shape of the dress particularly. That's incredibly useful in terms of deciding on the shape and style of the bouquet. And then we just run through prompting ideas. I might ask them what their favourite colour is, or their favourite flower, or perhaps what the bridesmaids are wearing, and perhaps start a theme going. I think it's really important to have a theme for your wedding flowers, so it's not too higgledy-piggledy, so it all just runs smoothly together. Here at McQueen's, we're renowned for a lot of our signature designs. We're renowned for being obviously contemporary, and a lot of our designs tend to be very simple with a twist. For instance, we'll use monochrome colours. We try not to mix varieties, flower varieties, and we always like to add a little twist in, but be it a twist of a leaf, a flex of a piece of grass, or an angle of a flower. It's the small details really for us that make a huge difference. The worst possible thing for me is to make flowers do something unnatural. I hate using wire in our wedding work. I think it makes it stiff, doesn't allow it to move freely. For instance, in wedding bouquets, I mean, for me, the wired bouquet is a thing of history. There's no real time scale as to when a bride should come and see us about their wedding flowers, but generally, flowers is one of the last things they'll do. They'll generally book the church, book the venue, choose their dress, and then come to us. I think probably the only thing after us would be the cake. Obviously today, everybody is very budget conscious, and my advice would be to keep it simple and stick to seasonal flowers, and wherever possible, British flowers. A typical request from a bride would be starting from her bridal bouquet, the buttonholes obviously for the groom, father's ushers, bridesmaids' bouquets. These days, headdresses are sort of a thing of the past. Moving on to the church, definitely something up at the altar and the pew ends, just to give it that romantic feel and that sort of ceremonial feel. And then into the venue for the reception. The table centre is definitely a must these days. What's very popular are very high table centres. We do an awful lot of candelabra arrangements, as well as contemporary glass vessels as well. That's certainly not the bare minimum, but the absolute must-haves. Here we have a really typical bridal bouquet. It's simple, it's dome-shaped, it's very neat. It's got a lovely detail at the binding point here with a pearl pin. And in my other hand here is a much smaller bouquet, which we would normally use as a bridesmaid's bouquet. Again, very simple, very pure. And again, with a small detail, the two small pins.
Well, lots of things to think about there. Kally, thank you so much for joining us in the
it's
studio.
It's a pleasure.
And welcome back, Victoria.
Thank you.
So, Kally, Katie has some very definite ideas. She's got yes. Peacock blue bridesmaids dresses, and I see here she's got her swatch.
A complete and utter dilemma. There is no flower that matches that colour whatsoever. However, having said that, I prefer to contrast colours rather than match them. And I think what would work best with this, and I was listening earlier, I think probably keeping it ivory would be the best option, especially if she's wearing ivory. She could either carry blue herself and the bridesmaids carry white, or they can both carry white. Judging by what you were saying earlier, I think probably, and judging by the dress you're wearing today, yeah. Hydrangeas will be a really good option, just perhaps a single stem. The dress is so full and so detailed, the simpler you go on the flowers the better.
Okay, so go simple for the bridal bouquet.
Exactly, but for the bridesmaids. Again, are they adult or are they child bridesmaids?
Three adults and one flower girl.
Right, again, I'd go more delicate. I'd probably use smaller headed flowers, things like freesia, a little bit of scent, in season at the time. We're coming towards the end of summer, so it's getting a little bit limiting, but freesia are always available. Always very bridal, very pretty, and do give that added extra scent, which is always nice on the special day.
Vicky, what other elements to the floral arrangements can you bring a whole look together with?
There's lots of things, and it's very dependent on your budget, Katie, and how much you actually want to spend. Flowers, as Kally would probably agree, always look nice as a place setting. So rather than having a favour, you could just have a single stem tied with a ribbon with the place card attached. Or if you want to go out and out for your wedding and really, you know, have the wow factor, a floral floral arch is simply stunning and something
hardly
that you...
Hardly a detail.
It's a rather big one.
It's a rather big one. Yeah.
But it's an absolute statement. And I think, you know, if you want to have the wow factor on your wedding day, that would be certainly something I would consider.
Would that take a long time, Kally, to put together something like that?
An arch?
An arch, yes.
Yes, I mean, it is one of the largest pieces that a bride might ask for her wedding day is an arch, and one of the most expensive, definitely. If you're on a tight budget, then probably not the way forward. But for me, it is, as you were saying, the finishing touches are what make the difference. The napkin detail, the chair backs, the buttonholes and how you present those, things like that, or you know, details in your hair, possibly maybe some fresh flowers in your hair. Those sorts of things for me make a huge difference.
Talking about the groom, we often forget about the groom. So obviously we've got the ideas for the bridal bouquet and the bridesmaids. Yeah. What about the buttonholes for the groom and the best man?
Again, I mean, I think we should really have some continuity, certainly with the personal flowers. Obviously, if you're carrying a hydrangea, I wouldn't suggest a hydrangea for his buttonhole, a little bit gross. But if then perhaps taken from the bridesmaids, maybe a beautiful sort of cluster of freesias, maybe backed, like you said, with herbs. I mean, I love using herbs in that way, particularly a sprig of rosemary works really well to back and make the flowers stand out even more.
It'll smell amazing,
exactly,
actually,
that
wouldn't it?
Too.
Is it still traditional for mothers of the bride to have a corsage?
Less and less so. It is, again, becoming a thing of the past. It depends how traditional the mother is. Some require it. Most of them these days quite happy not to have them.
Mm. So what about things like pew ends? Is that a way that you can save money by going from the pew ends?
We very often do that. We very often double up like that, and it's always something I suggest to the bride. Go for the pew ends because then you can use them again in the reception venue, tie them onto the back of the top table, particularly.
Absolutely.
Definitely.
And they don't have to be expensive either, do they,
no,
Kally?
No.
I mean, they could be foliage only without being flowers.
Or just herbs.
Just
tied on with a beautiful satin ribbon. Or yes, definitely, just a bloom, just a single head of hydrangea. Works really well. There's no reason, you know, why you should go over the top, especially if you're on a tight string.
So are you finding that a lot, obviously, in the current climate, that people are asking ways
yes.
to save money?
Yes, all the time. And we're always looking at ways for them in order to see that happens.
So what's your budget like, Katie?
I haven't...
Don't mind me asking.
No, well, I obviously, as with everything, as far as weddings are concerned, I'll go over it, I know that much. We're trying to save money by doing the table decorations ourselves.
Okay.
We're sourcing junk shops for vintage antique teapots for garden flowers.
Lovely idea.
It's very much up our street, actually.
Yeah.
It's the sort of thing I'd recommend and certainly would do at home.
Yeah.
And if it's a do-it-yourself thing, really go out and out for it and make it look like you've gone out and picked the flowers yourselves from the garden and put them in your jam jars, put them in your jugs and your teacups. That looks fabulous. I mean, that's very bridal to me. Yeah.
Fantastic. So lots of great ideas. So thank you so much, Kally.
It's a pleasure.
Thank you, Victoria. Hope we've helped you today, Katie.
You have, thank you.
That's all we've got time for on this show. On the series so far, we've helped you with dresses, cakes, flowers, and groom's outfits. Make sure you join us next time because it's a budget-busting bonanza for all you brides looking to cut some costs. You'd be completely crazy to miss it. Join us next time.